All right. This is the Chapter 10 Study Guide Solutions. The problem that we have here on the study guide is going to be a problem on the test. What we have is we have two alternatives. We have alternative A and alternative B. And what you need to do is you need to actually calculate all four use all four evaluation methods to evaluate it. And then you need to choose an alternative based on that evaluation method. So I have down here an example is if on payback, you're going to calculate both alternative A and alternative B, and you're going to choose the best payback and do the same thing for ROA and NPV and IRR. So not only do you need to get the correct answers, but you need to choose the best option based on your answers. And that's what that C part is, if you read the study guide. Okay, so we have both alternatives right here. And I'm going to go ahead and use the same examples. This is payback. So we have 4 years of cash flows for alternative A of $120,000, $40,000, $75,000, and $60,000. And then we have the $250,000 initial investment. What I always do is I do a cumulative column, as I've showed you before. So in year one, we have $120,000 brought in from the investment. In year two, we add the 120 with the 40, and we get 160,000. In year three, we add 75,000 to the 160, and we get 235,000. Now, here's what happens is somewhere after year three, this investment is paid back. Because if we add the 60,000 to 235, it's larger than the 250. So we know it's 3 point some fraction of years, some portion of years. The way we calculate that is we take what we have left, so 250,000 minus 235,000 gives us $15,000, and we take our cash flows from year four, because the assumption is that those are distributed evenly throughout the year, and we get 3.25 years. So again, we do our cumulative column until we are at a point where we're going to go ahead and pay the initial investment back. In this example, at year three, we're at $235,000, so it's 3 point some fraction of years. We're going to take the investment amount and subtract out what we've received. So it's what's left of $15,000 divided by our year four cash flow. On alternative B, we're going to do the same thing. So in our cumulative column, we have 85,000. Then we add 35 to it, and we get 120,000. Then we add 60,000 to it, and we get 180,000. So again, after year three, we're going to pay off this loan of 108, or not this loan, but we're going to pay off the investment of $185,000. And the question is where? So we have $5,000 left to pay it back. 185,000 less 180. And we divide that, I forgot my division sign, by 65,000. That's what our cash flow is for year four. And we get 3.08 years. So based on payback, we would choose alternative A because, I'm sorry, we choose alternative B because we pay the back the investment sooner. It's not much sooner, but it's sooner. So 3.08 years is less than 3.25, so we choose alternative B. Okay, now ROA is very easy to calculate. Okay, what we do is we take the average of our cash flows. So we add up all of our cash flows and divide it by the number of years. That's the first calculation you see on there. The 120 plus 40 plus 75 plus 60 divided by 4. And that gives us 73,750. And we divide that into our initial investment. We don't worry about positive or negative signs with this. And we get a 0.295. Now, if you don't memorize if you want a high or a low ROA. I want you to think about it in these terms. Would you want higher cash flows or a higher initial investment? And the answer, I hope, is that you would like higher cash flows, which is the top number. So the larger this is, the better. Again, for alternative B, we take the average of our four cash flows, which gives us 61,250. We divide it by our initial investment, and we get 3.31. Since 0.331 is larger than 0.295, we choose alternative B based on return on assets, or ROA. Now, net present value. I put both of the options on the same page here. We have our initial investment of $250,000, and we discount those cash flows. What the premise here is that we put a line in the sand of 12%. If we don't earn 12% on our money, we're not going to invest. So for the first one, when we take we go to the present value table and we grab our multipliers. I just did 0.10 for year zero because today is today, and it's just a way to do the math all the way across. And then we do PV for 1 year at 12%, and we get the 0.8929. 7972 is PV for 2 years at 12%, and then going down to the 0.6355 is PV for 3 years at 12%. So we do the math, we go ahead and discount our cash flows of year one through year four, and then we add everything together. In this example, we have a negative $19,449. So we have this investment is gonna give us less than 12% return, and we reject it. Remember that we accept an investment when the net present value is zero or greater. The good news is you won't have any zero answers, I don't think, on net present value. And then for alternative B, we do the same math. We go ahead and find the present value of our 4 years of cash flows using the present value table at 12%. When we do our math, when we add up our initial investment and our cash flows, we get $2,814. That's positive. So we accept this one. Now, when you look at these, of course, if we accept a project at net present value at our percentage, our case of E, if you will, our 12%, then we know that the return is higher than 12%. By the same token, if we reject one, we know that the return is less than 12%. And I say that because on IRR, what we have to do is we have to find the interest rate where the net present value is as close to zero as possible. And I went ahead and I put the initial problem, the initial net present value problem there in the top left quadrant, if you see that. And that's where we have that negative $19,449. And then I went down to 10% and it dropped it to $10,524. So I went ahead and I looked in the table at 10% and I got the 10% multipliers, and I just went ahead and did the math. On Excel, this is real easy. It's going to be a little bit of a challenge for you to do on by hand, but it is the disadvantage of not having to do all these problems on Excel or you all buying a financial calculator. So again, because when I went down to 10%, I was not, my present value wasn't close to zero. I went down to 6%, and it was too high. When I plugged in the 6% multipliers, I got $9,304. So I went up to 8%, and I got a negative $965. That's pretty close. So what I would say is the internal rate of return of alternative A is about 8%. Okay, let's look at alternative B. For IRR, again, we know that it's above 12%, but we don't know how high. I told you before that I'm not going to make you calculate the 13% present value factor, so I went up to 14%, and it is it gives us a negative $4,519, so we know that the 14% is too high. It's going to be, I mean, you can look at those numbers and kind of take a guess that it's going to be about 13%. So I would go ahead and say that the IRR is about 13% on this, even though we're not calculating it. And because we want the highest IRR, we're going to accept alternative B. So all of our four valuation methods give us the same answer. It gives us alternative B. And that's not always the case. I will tell you that your net present value and your IRR are going to choose the same alternative because they essentially are the same type of calculation. So again, you're going to have a problem like this, exactly like this, with different numbers on the test. You're also going to have problems from your study guide from Chapter 7. Those are actually going to be multiple choice. And then you will have an amortization table that you'll have to complete. Good luck on the test. If you have any questions, don't hesitate to contact me.